Hello and welcome to Unit 2 of our online course in Environmental Flows. This week we're focusing on a number of concepts fundamental to the science and management aspects of eFlows. I'll begin with the topic of habitat suitability, which was central to the first ecologically based approaches to the determination of eFlows, and it continues to be important and relevant today. The concept of habitats emerged in biology in the early 1900s, about the time that W.H. Shebley was calling for the California legislature to require dam owners to release flows from their dams. Habitats were recognized as the natural home or environment of organisms, and the boundaries were considered to be both physical, determined by the tolerances of the organism, and biological, determined by interactions with other species. Biologists understood that habitats occurred at multiple scales. The stream or river, of course, constitutes the main habitat, but organisms were also understood to have preferences for smaller habitats within the river, such as mesohabitats or mesohabitats like pools or riffles, and microhabitats related to specific patches within pools or riffles. Biologists recognized as well that the habitat needs of organisms change depending on their stage of life. Adult salmon ready to breed need gravel habitats for spawning, where eggs will be protected and temperatures will be held constant for the period of incubation and hatching. When the salmon fry emerge from the gravels, as they continue to grow, they need habitats with abundant food, especially insects, and shelter from predators. When salmon par become smolts, they're ready to migrate and need sufficient flows for movement downstream and unobstructed passage to the sea. Adult salmon returning from the sea have similar needs, but even more so because they're now large-bodied fish. In the context of eFlows, biologists characterize microhabitats in terms of water depth, velocity, wetted width of the channel, the grain size of bed sediments, and the cover provided for shelter. Relationships between these variables and suitability for particular species and life stages are formulated as shown in the figure on the left. Here, suitability is expressed on a scale of 0 to 1, with 1 representing the highest level of suitability. These relationships can also be expressed in two dimensions, as shown in the figure on the right. The different variables representing habitat suitability can also be combined to derive composite suitability indices, where the influence of different variables is given different weights. The area of suitable habitat can then be compared to the total area of the stream or river reach to calculate the weighted usable area versus discharge, as shown in the figure on the left. This figure expresses the weighted usable area versus discharge for a single species at a specific point in its life stage. Habitat availability as a function of discharge may be determined at mesoscale as well, as shown in these figures from the Larisia stream in the Piedmont area of northwest Italy. The figure on the left shows the distribution of mesohabitats at a discharge of 60 liters per second, while the figure on the right shows the distributions in the same reach of stream at a discharge of 250 liters per second. At the higher flows, the reach is composed primarily of high flow velocity rapids and riffles. This is also the scale of assessment used in the 1947 to 1949 eFlows work in the Colorado River, where biologists first mapped the changing proportions of pools and riffles as a function of flow levels. Mesohabitats can be visualized more easily than microhabitats and can therefore be mapped more easily. They also host multiple species. In describing these concepts of habitat suitability, I'm holding back on critiquing the strengths and weaknesses of the eFlows methods based upon them. We'll consider methods in much more detail later. But I do want to highlight that applying concepts of habitat requires detailed data on the preferences of species, and collecting those data is field intensive. It's been done on several species in North America and Europe, but much less in other areas. For those of you living in areas where rivers are inhabited by crocodiles, you'll understand at least one reason why this sort of field work has been limited. So take home messages from this lecture. First, habitats are the natural environments of species and exist on spatial scales ranging from the whole river to microhabitats used for very specific purposes. Second, microhabitats can be described in terms of water depth, velocity, wetted width, bed substrate and cover, and these variables can be combined into composite indices. And finally, mesohabitats are environments used by multiple species that can be more easily visualized and mapped as features like pools and riffles. Habitats are the basis for an important set of eFlow's approaches, which we'll look at in much more detail later in the course. That's the end of this lecture. Thanks very much.